And joining us again from Vancouver, BC, Ronald Wright, author of A Short History of Progress. Hello again.
Hello.
Well, before we get into tonight's discussion, I want to play a piece of tape from you. This comes from the 2011 documentary Surviving Progress, which is based on your book. Here's a short clip from that.
The poor people need more. There is no doubt about it. There is no discussion there. If you are average villager somewhere in Rajasthan or Punjab or Nigeria, you need more, period. There's a basic human decency compels you to say these people need more, more clean water, more basic food, more education for their children. The discussion closed, right, before it begins, right? But as far as us is concerned, we certainly could and should do with much, much, much less.
Okay, and to add to that, here's some statistics compiled by National Geographic magazine just this year. Take a look at this. The world population increased from 1 billion to 6 billion in 200 years. We've reached the 7 billion mark just this year, just after 12 years after hitting the 6 billion mark. 7 billion people, if we were all crammed in somewhere, it would fill an area the size of Los Angeles. We have 5 people around the world being born every second, but only 2 people are dying per second. And our population is set to increase to 9 billion in just over 30 years by the year 2045. Ronald Wright, given all of that, how do we generate a public conversation about population growth when this issue so easily crosses into individual autonomy and religious belief?
Yeah, it's a very tricky one. Very few people want to talk about overpopulation, although it used to be a big subject. I mean, back in the 60s and 70s, I can remember you would see bumper stickers that said, overpopulation is your baby, you know. And so people were taking it seriously then, but it has become a hot potato, partly for the reasons you mentioned, and of course because of the great disparity between rich and poor, and the fact that in the wealthy countries, population growth has in general fallen to or even below replacement rate, whereas in the poorer countries where people have no expectation of the basic necessities of life and therefore tend to have large families in the hope that a few of their children will survive to run the farm or whatever the business is and look after the parents in their old age. That's where the birth rates still remain very high, although it is worth noting that birth rates are falling, and there seems to be a clear correlation between greater prosperity and not just prosperity, but greater social security, a sense that there is a government who will give you a pension, that there will be schools, that your daughters can go to school. Education of girls and women is very important in reducing the birth rate. And then, of course, such things that Vaclav Smil was just mentioning, clean water, safe sewage disposal, just the basic decencies of life. When those become widely available, birth rates fall pretty quickly. But unfortunately, we still have something like 2 billion people living on less than $1.50 a day. And 2 billion people is greater than the entire population of the world when Queen Victoria died, which is only, you know, just over a century ago. So that's not progress.
There is another way that birth rates decline, and China has tried the strategy and its one-child policy. Is that something you see as a useful strategy that other countries might want to try out?
Well, of course, China had the luxury of having a totalitarian system, and so they could enforce this policy in a way that would be unimaginable in, or extremely difficult to do in more democratic countries. It's worth noting also that India, which is to a large degree a democracy, perhaps not as democratic as we like to think, but it is somewhat democratic, India also had a rather draconian attempt to reduce fertility by sterilizing people. And I think actually that the Indian attempt was one of the things that got population control a bad name, because it tended to be the poor who were getting sterilized, and it also emerged that they were very often not really being told what was happening to them. So there's definitely a bit of a bad smell around the idea of enforced reductions in the birth rate by whatever means. However, we have to come to grips with the growing population. As I mentioned, the rate of increase has started to slow, but on a world level, it is still much too high. And we're going to end up at least 9 billion by mid-century, as you mentioned, and that is probably too many, because not only is it 2 billion more people to mouths to feed, but it also, as the individual footprint of each person gets bigger, the impact on natural systems is likely to be much greater than simply going from 7 to 9. We're probably going to see, if present trends continue, we're going to see a doubling at least of the impact of human beings on the Earth's systems if we allow this to happen. And this is the other reason why it's so difficult to talk about population, because a poor person in Bangladesh is probably only having a 40th or a 50th of the effect on the Earth per head than people in countries such as Canada, the United States, and the European countries. So there's this equation between absolute human numbers and the amount of consumption and waste generation per head.
And also part of that equation, though, is if we stick with the China example, you know, China's population is changing and growing, not to the extent that it might have. But now they're facing this conundrum by their one-child policy that by, you know, 2030, they're not going to have enough working-age citizens. So you're sort of solving perhaps one problem, but creating another social and problem, and perhaps a more significant one, no?
Well, there are those people who say that you have to have a constantly growing population to keep the demographic pyramid, the sort of numbers of people in each age class, stable. And, you know, if you look at it purely in terms of economics and demographics, they have a point. On the other hand, though, we have one Earth. And quite clearly, you cannot allow human populations to keep on growing indefinitely. You know, it's even a very small rate of growth, like 1%, means a doubling every 70 years, that in one human lifetime. And 70 years is nothing in terms of the human career on Earth. So we have to bring the population down. I think there may be other ways to address this issue of, you know, not enough working age people supporting a large retirement population. That is obviously a bulge that is going to have to be gone through, just as, you know, back in the 60s and 70s, when world population was expanding at a very great rate, you had an enormous number of young people that had to be absorbed into society and jobs had to be found for them and so forth. And, you know, with varying degrees of success, that was achieved. And I think now we are going to see put in place structures that will enable us to deal with an older population for a while, but that's only a short-term problem. And it's much better to accept that short-term demographic problem than to allow things to continue to grow and therefore reap the whirlwind just a few generations down the road.
And another problem that we can throw into this equation of population growth is consumption. So where is the balance between, you know, sort of making the case for we've got to have fewer people on the planet versus the argument for, like, let's just stop consuming as much? Because when you look at countries like China and India, if they sort of ramp up to the consumption levels that we have here in the West, we're in a really sticky situation.
Well, yes, I think most people would agree that, you know, if another 2 billion or 3 billion consumers come in at the Western level, that will certainly overload the Earth and cause general collapse worldwide. So, but on the other hand, it's sort of unfair to pick on these countries. I mean, even though the Chinese economy is now greater than the American economy, per capita, it is much, much less. So really, we in the prosperous, high-income countries, the wealthy countries, have to take the lead here. We cannot expect countries like India and China to limit their population and their consumption if we don't do the same here. And let us remember that the gulf between rich and poor, both within countries and between countries, has accelerated enormously in the past 30 years. And that, in fact, that gap between rich and poor was decreasing up until sometime in the 1960s or 70s, certainly within modern social democracies such as the European countries and Canada and the United States too, largely as a result of policies that were put in after the Second World War. It was seen as a bad thing to have too big a gap between rich and poor. And history tells us that it is a bad thing because it leads to revolution, it leads to uprising, it leads to huge masses of people protesting in the streets. I think the really sad thing is that what happened in the late 70s and early 80s is that the lessons of the first half of the 20th century were torn up by people who just didn't want to believe it anymore. 100 million people, at least, died in the 20th century's wars. And the lesson of that terrible bloodletting was that if you don't want Bolshevism, anarchism, Nazism, any of these extreme, desperate movements that get people out onto the fighting in the streets, if you don't want those things, you cannot have unregulated capitalism that tends to always, when it's unregulated, the wealth always goes to the top, leaving people at the bottom in desperate circumstances and very often without work. And when you've got a lot of young people without work, what do? They get out on the street. They go into crime, and eventually crime develops into unrest, and unrest becomes revolution. That was the lesson of the first half of the 20th century. So after the Second World War, we created the welfare states, and we brought in the Keynesian ideas of economics, that you taxed the people at the top and you redistributed that wealth. So you subsidized healthcare through taxation. You subsidized public education, even at university level. When I went to university, I didn't have to pay tuition. All of this was done in the interests of the greater good and in keeping a reasonable spread between rich and poor. There's still plenty of rich people around, but the spread was reasonable. And that was something that had emerged from the very painful, bloody lessons of the first half of the 20th century. And then along came Milton Friedman and the Chicago Boys and his disciples, Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan. And they just said, well, why do we need all this regulation? Let's just get rid of it and let capitalism rich. And everybody will get, let capitalism rip. And everybody will get rich and it'll trickle down and we'll get rid of poverty that way. Well, 30 years later, has that worked? I don't think so. We have 2 billion people out of the 7 billion living in desperate straits, probably worse than anything that existed in the past.
Seems to me you're suggesting that capitalism itself might be a progress trap.
Unregulated, yes. I'm not suggesting we go back to communism, but I am suggesting that regulated capitalism seems to be the best way forward. And that was the lesson learned as the result of the First and Second World Wars, that you can't let it rip because it will lead to war and revolution and militarism and so forth. You have to redistribute the wealth. You have to create a sense that everybody has a stake in the society and everybody receives something from the society. Obviously, you still have to reward effort. You still have to reward hard work and ingenuity. But you cannot go back to this sort of old-fashioned Victorian belief known as social Darwinism, where you just let the people at the bottom starve and die on the streets because that's all they deserve anyway. That is the sort of old way of thinking that led us into so much bloodshed and which we have to abandon. And we've learned that lesson, well, twice really, with two world wars. Mm. And we were actually implementing policies to affect this. And then it all got torn up with the emergence of the new right, which seems to me to be getting increasingly extreme and which is advocating the very worst forms of progress. In other words, ripping fossil fuels out of the ground as fast as you can, doing it with very minimal environmental controls. We now have a government in Canada trying to tear up environmental regulations, some of which go right back to 1868, in the interest of just letting business rip and without any serious consideration of the long-term social and environmental consequences.
Okay, I just want to jump in here, Ronald, because I want to talk about what the fix is here. How do you reform all this? And in your book, you write that the reform needed is neither anti-American, anti-capitalist, not even deep environmentalist. A lot has happened since your book, in reality, on the streets, if we talk about the Occupy movement. Do you still stand by that statement?
Yeah, I think that there's a moderate way forward. I think that we had something that was working after the Second World War, which was managed capitalism and redistributive taxation and social policies. I think, and of course, those things still survive quite well in some of the countries of the European Union and in the sort of philosophy of the European Union as a whole. Now, the European Union is not perfect by any means, but it is the place where the ideals of social democracy and the ideals of creating a fair and just society and doing so in a sustainable way, where those ideals are still upheld, even though they're having a hard time carrying them out. But those ideals are upheld. And there's a great deal of resistance to, say, reducing upper tax levels and so forth. So we had something that worked, and we are still practicing that in some parts of the world, and I think we can go back to that. At a time when people are dying on the streets and other people are, buying 400-foot yachts that are so big they can't even go anywhere except a commercial harbor, we need to look at the upper rate of taxation. Plato, back at the time, ancient Greece, Plato suggested that in a healthy society there shouldn't be more than a 5-to-1 spread between the income of the people at the top and the people at the bottom. Now, 5-to-1 is pretty narrow, and I think we could certainly look at something higher than that. But this present system we have, where the spread is thousands to one, that is, A, it's very dangerous, and secondly, it's very recent. I mean, you've only got to go back to about 1979, and the spread in income between the CEO of a major American corporation and the shop floor worker was 39-to-1 on average. And you look at those same corporations today, the spread is way over 1,000-to-1. So something clearly has gone off the rails.
And something clearly is irritating people, and we see that in Occupy. That's why so many people are out on the streets, 99%, 1%. But the criticism of a movement like that, when you say people are going to be out on the streets, the criticism of Occupy is that they haven't had a coherent message. They haven't presented potential solutions. Is that a problem as you see it?
Well, I think at the moment, this is a movement that's in its very early stages, and they have been drawing attention with this slogan, we are the 99%. They've been drawing attention to this very recent and rapid growth in income disparity. And I think that is step one. Step two, once people have absorbed that message and begun to recognize that this is a real problem, step two will be to look at ways of reducing this. And there are many, many ways of tackling it. I mean, I think one of the most interesting ideas is the Tobin tax, or Robin Hood tax, as it's sometimes called, which would be, this would be done on a worldwide basis, not a national basis, and it would put a very small levy on all the enormous sums of money that slosh around the planet every day in speculation and currency transactions. Very large sums of money. A tiny tax on that, less than 0.5%, would raise the kind of money that is needed to lift the bottom 2 billion out of dire poverty, and it would raise it from the people who have more money than they know what to do with, and it would do it on a worldwide basis so that it isn't any one country having to shoulder the burden. But it would certainly be a start in redressing this obscene disparity between the haves and the have-nots.
But yet, Occupy swelled, it ebbed, it flowed, it's sort of dormant. Is that kind of movement be enough to accomplish it and put the pressure on the leaders to do something different, as you're suggesting?
Well, we don't know. As I say, the movement's in its early stages. It sort of went dormant with the winter and with the attempts to clear public squares and so forth. My guess is that if things aren't done, we will see this Occupy movement happening again. And it's not only the Occupy movement. There's a wave of social unrest around the world. The so-called Arab Spring being part of that. There has also been a huge change in Latin America. Not only popular movements, but the emergence of democratically elected, left-of-center, moderate regimes that are achieving some real results in terms of better life expectancy, better health, better support and poverty reduction. In countries that used to be basket cases, and this has happened, I think, largely because the United States used to be paranoid about any kind of progressive regime in Latin America and would immediately overthrow it in a CIA-inspired coup and would then install a right-wing dictator to keep everybody down and keep the place good for American corporations. Well, that era has passed since the end of the Cold War, and the United States has other places to worry about. Latin America's kind of slipped off their radar, but the result of that has been that, you know, you look at Brazil, you look at Peru, you look at Bolivia, you look at Ecuador, and of course Venezuela, which is perhaps not the ideal model because that one, I think, is at risk of being too dictatorial, but the others are genuine democratic reform movements at the national level. If it can happen in Latin America, I see no reason why we can't see more of that worldwide.
Curious, Ronald, right? People around the world have been out on the streets in the last year and a half. Have you been out there? Have you been part of Occupy?
I have not camped out in a tent in a square.
but if that's what
I've
it takes.
I've been down there. I've been down there, and I am watching this with interest. And I think what's encouraging about it is that at the moment, this is a relatively peaceful mass movement. And I think it's in everyone's interest to make sure that it stays that way. I mean, what the nightmare that is that we should all remember is what it was like in the 1920s and 1930s, when you had extreme groups of right and left marching in the streets, smashing shops, persecuting minorities, and destabilizing society, particularly in Europe. We do not want to see that sort of thing again. And let's remember what happened in the United States during the Great Depression, when a quarter of the workforce was out of work and had no prospects of it. What happened was that the FDR administration brought in make work projects, put people to work by doing useful things, building parks, building roads, building houses. You know, governments don't have to cut taxes for corporations to put people to work. Governments can simply put people to work, and that's what they did in the last big crisis of inequality and poverty and disparity between rich and poor, which was the Great Depression.
You know, the New York Times called the Occupy movement, I think, the new progressive movement, and we've been talking about progress for the last two nights. I'm just wondering, do you think it's an abuse of the word progress to characterize protesters, many of whom are calling, you know, to go back to a simpler time, as progressive?
Well, as I said at the outset, I mean, progress means many different things to different people. I think this movement is progressive in the sense that they are looking ahead to ways to address the problems that are building up and becoming ever more serious as we're not dealing with them. And in that sense, it's progressive. Of course, there may be naive elements who think, you know, we can all go back to a way of life that we see on the movies from the 19th century, which perhaps never really happened, and which we certainly could not go back to with 7 billion people in the world. I mean, you know, in the 1820s, there was only 1 billion people in the world. And you can just probably feed 1 billion people with subsistence farming. You certainly can't feed 7 billion people with subsistence farming without some very, very profound adjustments to where people live and how they work. And in some parts of the world, you know, the populations have simply outstripped the ability of those of the agricultural land in those countries to feed them. Let's not be naive. I don't think people here in this Occupy movement advocating, you know, a return to some kind of utopia from the sepia-toned utopia from the past. I think what they're saying is, look, we used to have fairer societies. We used to have universal health care, free secondary education, and even free post-secondary education. We used to see the rich countries giving substantial aid to the poor countries and putting in useful projects to raise people out of poverty. We used to see a lot of that, but now we're not seeing any of it because governments don't want to be in the business of governing anymore. They don't want to tax people who have money, so therefore they are shutting down programs and going around trying to take money from the most vulnerable people, the middle class, the working class, anyone who has it but who isn't powerful and organized enough to make a real protest. So what they're saying is, okay, it is time we made a real progress. It is time that we got out there. And I think the one reason it's so many young people is that they realize that the old idea of progress, that everything was going to get bigger and better forever, and everybody, each generation was going to be richer and live in a better house and have a bigger car than the one before, they know that that dream is dead. And they know that any idea that it is not dead is a big lie. And that's where a lot of their anger comes from. What they're trying to do is reclaim the future for themselves and for their descendants. Because a lot of what we're doing with the present let capitalism rip mentality is that we're not just stealing from the poor and destroying the environment, we are stealing from our own descendants. We are robbing the future to fuel a binge of stuff that so many of us have so much stuff, we don't know what to do with it. People are renting storage spaces and filling it up all the junk they can't keep in their 5,000 square foot houses. It's ridiculous. It has to change.
Okay, Ronald, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you very much. This is certainly a conversation that is really just in its infancy and we'll be talking a lot about in the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.